So let's do another activity, in this case with an FIR filter. This is primarily conceptual activities, very similar, to just make sure that you acquire the language. And we are working this out, pen and pencils, but it is really important to use a computer-aided tool such as MATLAB, OTIF, to start designing, simulating, and implementing these filters. So, incidentally, by the way, one more point in the previous filter that we saw in the previous problem. So, we had implemented a three-point moving average filter, and we went from a non-causal implementation where we have future inputs to a causal implementation. And we made the point that this was a special type of a more general type of filters, which is these FIR filters here, where these filter coefficients are allowed to change. And that's what we're going to see in this problem. We also made the point that whether you're talking about moving average filter or FIR filters in general or IIR filters, all you need are scalar multipliers, delayer blocks, and summing blocks. And so you're able to create these block diagrams, and this is all you need for implementing all these filters, which of course is available in any CPU, in any processor, etc. And I mentioned that it is highly optimized in the case of digital signal processor, and in the last 15 years, even 15 years ago, we were already able to do like 2.4 to 2.5 billion, billion with a B, multiply accumulate operations per second, which for real-time applications is quite important. Now, one more point. So you say, okay, this is a moving average. Moving average filter is a smoother, is a low-pass filter. So for instance, what will happen if we apply this filter to a signal that looks like this? Like, let's imagine that we have a sinusoidal signal. And it has like some noise on it, maybe high frequency noise, maybe 60 hertz noise, whatever, some noise. So this is your N, this is your X of N, and you apply this filter, which you could think of it as the impulse response, right? This is N, has like 3 points there, right? One third. And you are doing a convolution. Filtering is implemented with convolution of x of n times these b coefficients, which we are going to see that this is equivalent to the impulse response, h of n. Okay? What are you doing? Well, just think, if you are smoothing, if you are picking three values and averaging them, you're getting a smooth version. You're removing high frequency components, and therefore you are implementing a low pass filter. Now, we still need to see how do you go from those coefficients to the frequency response. Meaning, if I give you a set of coefficients like one third, one third, one third, well, what is the cutoff frequency of that filter? You know, how good of a filter it is? Or if I give you a particular frequency response that I want, how do I get the filter coefficients? This V0, V1, V2, etc. Make sense? But just remember, these moving average filters, where all the coefficients are the same, in this case, one third, one third, one third, when you pass them through a signal that has high frequency noise, it will have a tendency to, smooth the signal, like what happens when you average. Now, in this case, now, we are working with an FIR filter. The BK coefficients are 2, 4, 2, 1. Okay. This, by the way, is also the impulse response of the filter. Meaning, if you put an impulse at the input, you can we will see when we write the differential equation, the output, the response of the system, will be this filter coefficient. So the impulse response, 2, 4, 2, 1. That's the vector with impulse response. Now, if you apply the convolution operation of the impulse response times a signal, you are applying, you are implementing that filter, you are implementing the difference equation, you are calculating the output. So let's determine the type of filter. That's A. This is clearly an FIR filter, finite impulse response. Notice the finite, the response does not go all the way to infinity. And in the case of FIR filters, the filter coefficients, the B coefficients, are the impulse response of the system. Okay. Now, the impulse response of the system completely characterizes the system. Once again, we're talking about impulse response. Let's partition that. Response means output, the output of the system. When the input is an impulse function. Okay. And because it's finite, we call this finite impulse response filters. B, write the difference equation. So what is the difference equation? Y of n, in this case, it will be 2 times x of n plus 4 x of m minus 1 plus 2 x of m minus 2 plus 1 x of n minus 3. Now notice, if we had put an impulse at the input, meaning if our input was an impulse, x of m, which is a signal that is zero everywhere at all ends, except as at zero, which is equal to one, if we put an impulse, right, the output is the impulse response, meaning if this is our system here, if we put an impulse at the input, by definition, this is LTI, okay? The output is an impulse response. Well, for any system, you can put an impulse, and you will get an impulse response. But for LTI systems, for linear time invariant systems, you put an impulse at the input, and you get an impulse response, right? Like in any other system, you get an output when the input is an impulse, but that impulse response completely characterizes the system. Meaning, once you know x of n, you can find the output for any other input, and you can also find the frequency response. It's a complete characterization of the system. But what type of system? Only LTI. So if we do that, notice that we can find the output when we do this, the output now is the impulse response. H of n is equal to 2 times delta of n plus 4 times delta of m minus 1 plus 2 times delta of m minus 2 plus 1 x of m minus 3. And if you plot this, right, you get this in vector form is the 2, 4, 2, 1, which equals the filter coefficients that we started. Now compute the output of the system for a particular input, x of n, and we have there a particular input, right? 0, 0, 0, 0, 2, 4, 6, 4, 2, 0, 0, 0. What is the output? Well, either you can put this into the difference equation and compute the output. That's also equivalent to the output of a system for a particular input. Once you know the impulse response, is the convolution of the input with the impulse response. Okay? So you can also do it in MATLAB. I'm going to leave this as homework, as y equals convolution of x with h, or a convolution of h with x, or convolution b with x, or convolution x with b. Keep in mind though that in the convolution, the length of the vector and the n. So check the help file, or also you can do this with filter. Filter b or h 1x. And what you're implementing in that case is that difference equation. Filter order. Okay. Our order, right? Here you have it. We have a filter with an order m equals 3. Okay, now notice that there are four values, right? So x of 0, so 1, 2, 3, 4. But this is what we refer to as the order of the filter. Okay, now in general, remember that the difference equation for an FIR filter, for any FIR filter, is b0 x of n plus b1 x of m minus 1 plus, because of implementation, plus bm x of m minus m, where m is the filter order, which can be expressed mathematically as a sum, notice all these pluses, of bk x of m minus k for k equals 0 all the way to m, where m is the filter order. So filter order is m. In this case, we did a causal implementation because the output depends on the present input and past inputs. You should know that for FIR filters, the filter coefficients are a complete characterization of the filter, in the sense that you can find the output for any other input, you can find the frequency response, etc. In fact, the FIR filters, in finite impulse response filters, the filter coefficients equal the impulse response. And you can convince yourself by just putting an impulse at the input, a signal where it's zero everywhere, except at n equals zero, which will be one. So you put an impulse at the input, you get the output, a response, you get the output. We call that the impulse response, the response of the system when the input is an impulse. And if it is a LTI system, you will always have an impulse response for a system. You put an impulse, you get an output. You call that the impulse response. But if the system is linear time invariant, we're going to see that in a future activity, the impulse response is a complete characterization of the system. As you can see here, as I mentioned, why is that? Well, you pick any input and you do the convolution sum with the impulse response, you get the output. Okay? Or you know that the impulse response also determines the filter. It's really given by the filter coefficients of the difference equation. And the difference equation is a complete characterization of the system. Now, remember that in general, an FIR filter has this difference equation right here, which also could be expressed in the form of a convolution sum, where this is your impulse response. Thank you.